Penguin Random House Audio presents Wonder Drug, The Secret History of Thalidomide in America and Its Hidden Victims. This is the author, Jennifer Vanderbes. For Annika and Ellery, and for all those who are not counted. Prologue. On a hot August night in 1962, Anne Morris felt her first contraction. Her husband, Doug, guided her out of their small Cincinnati apartment where a gleaming crib and piles of hand-sewn baby quilts had been arranged. Settling into their new Chevrolet, in anticipation of the baby, Doug had surrendered his beloved Corvette, the couple drove 5 minutes through the quiet, dark city streets to the Jewish hospital. In the labor ward, Anne's pain intensified, and her contractions continued into the next day. At 31, Anne, who had married Doug just a year earlier, was a little old to be having her first baby. But labor was progressing normally, and Anne, raised on a Kentucky farm where she picked tobacco and slaughtered chickens, was not one to wilt at discomfort. Her only complaint, in an otherwise easy pregnancy, had been morning sickness, and her doctor had given her a small white bottle of vitamins, which eased her nausea. When Anne awoke in the hospital after the baby's delivery, Doug entered the room, grim-faced. He told her that their newborn, a girl, was missing arms and legs. She was not expected to live long. The couple had a list of baby names, but now their first choice, Gail Elizabeth, seemed wrong. In fact, the whole list seemed off. They scrambled to come up with something and landed on Carolyn Jean. While Anne was sedated, the hospital arranged to place the girl in foster care and urged Doug and Anne not to even see her. Doug went home to destroy the photos he had taken of Anne gleefully preparing for the baby. Meanwhile, Anne remained alone in a private hospital room, away from other new mothers, until, finally, the delivering doctor appeared with an odd question. Had Anne gone to Canada and bought thalidomide? Anne had first read about thalidomide a week earlier in Life magazine. An article called "The Drug That Left a Trail of Heartbreak" showed page after page of photographs of armless infants in Europe. Anne had shuddered at the German tragedy, but felt no connection to it. She had never been overseas and told the doctor she certainly hadn't gone to Canada to get a drug. She gave the matter no more thought. Anne was never contacted by the FDA or by the Ohio or Cincinnati health authorities. No doctor or nurse from the Jewish hospital ever told her that within the past year, at least 4 other babies had been born at the same hospital with the same deformity, focomelia, a birth defect so rare that most doctors would never encounter a single case. And no one would tell her that the Cincinnati-based William S. Merrill Company, located at 110 East Amity Road, just 15 minutes across town from her home, had sent millions of thalidomide samples to more than 1,200 doctors across the country, including 200 obstetricians. For 3 years, these pills, in various colors and dosages, without proper labels, had been casually handed out for everything from insomnia to headaches to morning sickness. The baby, Carolyn Jean, survived. She spent almost a year in foster care until she was finally reclaimed by her parents. Despite all predictions, she thrived, becoming a professional artist and a mother of 4. Over the years, when people asked Anne what had caused her daughter's disfigurement, Anne would say, "It's just one of those things that happens." In July of 1962, a sleeping pill billed as the safest thing since water was revealed to have killed or disfigured more than 10,000 babies worldwide in the single largest Holocaust in medical history. Sensational images of legless, armless infants filled newspapers. Politicians admonished pharmaceutical firms. Pills of every kind fell under suspicion. At the peak of the baby boom, the bliss of impending motherhood became fraught with dread. Women unfortunate enough to have taken thalidomide, often consuming only a single tablet at the behest of their doctor, were cast as wayward druggies. And thousands of parents were left to raise children with such extreme and unprecedented physical malformations that the medical profession lacked any knowledge to assist. The question emerged: who should have protected the world from this catastrophe? What bureaucratic safeguards could have foreseen it? Was it an unavoidable accident of the era's chemical wizardry, or had some negligence, some deliberate disregard fueled by greed, maimed those thousands of babies. As government agencies and courts scrambled to investigate the disaster, a sinister story came to light. Thalidomide had been created by a Nazi-founded German pharmaceutical firm that apparently bullied doctors and buried documents. For 4 years, the company had sold and licensed the drug across the globe, hailing it as completely atoxic, safe for everyone, children and pregnant women included, with scant data to back the claims. Expectant mothers in almost 50 countries had innocently taken the toxic sedative, and the shock of their maimed babies struck a huge blow to public confidence in the booming post-war pharmaceuticals industry. Since World War II, when the manufacture of antibiotics and antimalarials bolstered drug firms, pharmaceuticals had become a multi-billion dollar business. By 1960, drugs were the most profitable industry in the United States. Pills promising to ease every ache, pain, and worry became a trusted part of daily life. Thalidomide in particular held an unprecedented, glittering promise. It was billed as a one-size-fits-all drug, free of risk, no addiction, no side effects, no chance of overdose. It looked like the pharmaceutical world's unsinkable ship, but no one, not the chemists who patented it, the doctors who prescribed it, or the firms that sold it, knew how the drug worked inside the human body. The research had been shoddy, the safety claims imprudent. By the time thalidomide had been consumed by millions around the world and the drug's trail of damage came to light, the public asked, what drove the creation of wonder drugs, wellness or profit? And if something went wildly wrong, who would be held accountable? Behind the tale of slapdash science and corporate callousness lay an equally compelling, heartening story of quiet heroism. Around the globe, a few lone doctors, parents, and journalists had, over a grueling year, detected the birth defects, sometimes in their own children, and collectively sounded the alarm, forcing the drug firms disavowing thalidomide's dangers to recall the product. No government agency or health authority had done what this loosely knit group of concerned citizens had: expose and stop the largest pharmaceutical scandal of the 20th century. When I first came across records of their extraordinary feat, I wanted to honor these renegades. A German pediatrician, trying to escape the shame of his father's Nazi past, risked his career to battle a powerful drug firm. A young German lawyer, seeking justice for his limbless son, launched the largest criminal trial in Germany since Nuremberg. A cocksure Australian obstetrician, devastated to learn that the drug he had given to his pregnant patients had maimed their babies, cobbled together his own animal research lab in a parking lot shed to prove the drug's dangers. But my primary focus in this book is the relatively unknown story of thalidomide in America. As the only country in the world that refused to put thalidomide on the market during its initial launch, the United States brought its own valiant cast to the tale. Eleanor Kamath, a young American reporter stationed in Germany, fought to make the drug's dangers international news. Helen Tausig, a deaf female pediatric heart surgeon, flew to Germany to gather evidence. Barbara Moulton, a Food and Drug Administration official and the first female whistleblower in American history, risked her career to reform the agency. Morton Mintz, an upstart Washington Post reporter with a disabled child, broke the chilling news. Estes Kefauver, a rogue U.S. senator from Tennessee, used the thalidomide episode to force Congress to overhaul the drug industry. But chief among the heroes of this saga is Frances Kelsey, the only doctor in the world to recognize danger in thalidomide's scientific paperwork. As an FDA medical reviewer, Kelsey single-handedly kept thalidomide off the American market, a bureaucratic battle that consumed nearly a year and a half of her life. For this, the demure married mother of two earned the media spotlight in 1962 and became a national hero. President John F. Kennedy awarded her a medal. Her photograph graced Life magazine. At a time when every safeguard around the world had failed, so powerful was the appeal of Frances Kelsey's incorruptibility that her story came to obscure a disturbing footnote in the American thalidomide story, namely, that the drug had been widely circulated within the United States. While awaiting FDA approval, the William S. Merrill Company had launched clinical trials so vast and informal that the FDA would eventually beg the Justice Department to bring criminal charges against the firm. This book involved 283 interviews with victims, scientists, lawyers, doctors, and journalists across the globe, as well as visits to public and private archives and various courthouses. I probed thousands of decades-old documents.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.